Thank you. Welcome to Guelph Citadel Online. Would you please join me for our call to worship? This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Would you join me in prayer? Father God, we are tired. We've been wandering for over a year through this pandemic. We long for days since past. We know that you have laid this path out before us, yet we yearn for something else. Lord, guide us into your presence. Guide us back to you. It is in you that we can experience hope, love, and a refreshing of our spirits. Lord, you alone are good, and we simply long to be with you. Let us be present with you this morning as we worship. Amen.
Stories of the Bible. Jesus feeds the 5,000. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love. He did many miracles and healed people of their sickness.
Oh, hey everyone!
A huge crowd kept following him wherever he went, because they saw his miraculous signs as he healed the sick. A crowd started to gather around Jesus. There were 5,000 men and many more women and children. Turning to Philip, he asked,
"Hey, Philip!
Where can we buy bread to feed all these people?" You see, Jesus was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. Philip replied, "Even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed them.
Hey, I got an idea.
Then Andrew spoke up. There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good is that with this huge crowd? Jesus said, tell everyone to sit down.
Right, everyone, sit down.
Then Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks to God, and gave them to the people.
Here you go.
Afterward, he did the same with the fish, and they all ate as much as they wanted.
Want some more?
I'm all good, thanks.
After everyone was full, Jesus told his disciples, now gather the leftovers so that nothing is wasted.
You got it.
So they picked up the pieces and filled 12 baskets with scraps left by the people who had eaten from the 5 barley loaves and 2 fish.
Good morning, friends. Let me begin today by simply saying that you and I are the beloved children of God. Now, that's a very hard thing to claim because, as Major Leanne reminded us last week, it's very easy for us to think that we are what we do, we are what other people say about us, or we are what we have. But the truth that Jesus announces is that we are, like Jesus himself, a beloved child of God. And it's very, very important that as we live in this world that keeps telling us, no, you are what you do, you are what people say, you are what you have, that we listen to that voice that keeps telling us, you are my beloved. On you, my favor rests. So this morning, I want to talk about how we can more fully become the beloved, if that's in fact true. Because from the moment that we claim the truth of being the beloved, we are then faced with the call to become who we are. Well, the story we heard in our scripture reading this morning was a story about bread. Now, it didn't quite come through in the animated version that we heard earlier, but Matthew's gospel tells us in chapter 14 that Jesus took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it. And you know, Jesus did exactly the same thing at the Last Supper. He took bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it. And then when Jesus entered the home with those two disciples that he met on the road to Emmaus, he took bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it. And they recognized him. Well, what I'd like you to hear today is that those four words summarize the life of Jesus. Jesus is the one who is taken by God, who is blessed by God, who is broken on the cross, and who is given to the world. But you know, these same four words are also the words that summarize your life as the beloved. Because you, your spiritual life, your life as the beloved sons and daughters of God, is a life that is taken, that is blessed, that is broken, and that is given. And I'd like very much if today you would just remember these four words. If you would just go home later today and say, I'm taken, I'm blessed, I'm broken, I'm given. Because these four words are the words that I want to give you this morning so that you can claim what it means to be the beloved sons and daughters of God. Because if you can live your life as the taken, the blessed, the broken, and the given, then the world will recognize Jesus in you. In the breaking of the bread, in the breaking of your life. So let's spend a few moments this morning taking a look at each of these four movements. And the first one is that you are taken. Now, do you believe that God has taken you? You know, Scripture gives us a little softer term for this when it says that God has chosen you. In John 15, 16, we read, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit that will last." Now think about that for a moment. You are chosen by God. That means that God has seen you from all eternity as precious in his eyes, as unique. There is no other than you that is like you. There is no other person that is exactly like you. You are unique and you have a unique role to play in God's story. Now, most people don't believe that at all. Most people don't even think that they're welcome in the world, but God is saying to you and to me, I have seen you from all eternity in your uniqueness. You are my chosen one. You are special in my eyes. And what I hope that you'll realize today is that if you believe that you are chosen, it doesn't mean that others are not chosen. Think about what it means to be chosen. And what it means to many people in the world today. Generally, when we hear someone say that they've been chosen, it means that they're the best. Well, I've been chosen best in my class, and too bad for the rest of you. If you say that you're chosen for an award, then that means that others didn't get the award. If you're chosen to be president of a company, well, others didn't make it. But in God's way, that is not true at all. In fact, if you believe that you are chosen, then God gives you eyes to see the chosenness of others as well. And you will suddenly discover that your chosenness, your uniqueness, opens up in your heart a place where you can say, hey, brother, hey, sister, you too are unique in God's eyes. And it doesn't take anything away from my uniqueness. Now, friends, that is great news. But it's also very hard to claim in a world of statistics, in a world where you often think that you're just a number. But I want you to hold on to it, because it's the first sign that you are beloved. Now, the second sign of your belovedness is that you are blessed. Do you know where the word blessed comes from? It comes from the word benediction. And the word benediction comes from the two words bene and dictus, or diction. Bene meaning good, and dictus meaning sayings. Benediction means good sayings. So to understand that you're blessed is to understand that God is saying good things to you. You know, Henry Nouwen, in his book, The Life of the Beloved, describes how one day at the Daybreak community where he lived and ministered, a disabled community member named Janet came up and asked him for a blessing. Now, Henry was distracted by other things, so he quickly traced the sign of the cross on her forehead. "No," protested Janet. "I want a real blessing." Well, Henry understood then how he had been insensitive to her need, and he promised that at the next prayer service, he would have a special blessing for her. Well, at the end of that prayer service, About 30 people were sitting in a circle on the floor, and Henry announced, "Janet has asked me for a special blessing." He didn't quite know what she was seeking from him, but her next move left no doubt. She walked up to him and she wrapped her arms around him. And as he embraced her in return, her slight form was almost covered by the folds of the white robe that he wore while leading worship. And as they held each other, Henry said, "Janet, I want you to know that you are God's beloved daughter, that you are precious in God's eyes, you are beautiful. Your smile, your kindness to the people in your house, and all of the good things that you do show what a beautiful human being you are. I know you feel a little low these days and that there's some sadness in your heart, but I want you to remember who you are, a very special person, deeply loved by God and all of the people who are here with you." Well, Janet raised her head and she looked at him. Her beaming smile told him that she had truly understood and received the blessing. Well, what happened next was unexpected. As Janet returned to her place, another woman raised her hand, and she too wanted a blessing. She stood up and embraced Henry, laying her face against his chest. And after that, a great many more of the disabled members of the community took their turn, coming up for the same sort of blessing. For Henry, the most touching moment was when one of the assistants, a 24-year-old college student, raised his hand and asked, "What about me?" John was a big, burly young man, an athlete, and Henry did the same thing with him, wrapping his arms around him and saying, "John, it is so good that you are here. You are God's beloved son." John looked back with tears in his eyes, and he simply said, "Thank you. Thank you very much." Well, friends, we are all called to claim the blessing and to bless people wherever we go. That's our Christian call, to say good things of people. Not to give them little compliments, but to say good things about their being human, about their belovedness. But you know, we are also broken. And there's a deep sense that much of the brokenness in this world has a lot to do with relationships. You know, maybe you and I are not poor physically or economically, but we may be poor because there is a brokenness in our hearts. And each of us will know what that means. Husband and wife will not be able to speak well of each other. Children and parents feel brokenness in their relationship. Friends that you thought were there for you suddenly can't respond to your needs. You can feel an enormous inner anguish and an enormous inner pain. You know, if I ask myself what is my biggest suffering, it almost always has something to do with a brokenness in a relationship. We all have broken hearts. Somewhere, people did not love us the way we want to be loved. Somewhere, we feel rejected, abandoned, misunderstood, marginalized. What do we do with that? Well, I want to give you two thoughts about this today. First of all, you have to have the courage to embrace your brokenness and not deny it, to befriend your brokenness, to say, "Yes, I'm in pain, and I'm not going to pretend I'm not. I'm hurting, I'm crying out, I'm in pain, but it is my brokenness. And just as I am unique, I claim my unique pain." We have to have the courage to embrace our brokenness, to claim it as our pain. That's what Jesus means when he talks about taking up your cross. He doesn't say make a cross for someone else. He doesn't say create a cross for yourself. He simply says embrace your cross and say, "It's mine." It's hard to be a happy and joyful person when you always deny your brokenness. "Oh, it's not so bad. I'll just look at it from another angle." No, friends, we need to look our brokenness in the face and not be afraid of it. And secondly, I would say to you, to take your brokenness and put your brokenness under the blessing. Put the brokenness under the blessing that says, "You are good. You are beloved." To many of us, we live under the curse. Many of us say, "Well, I wasn't good anyhow, and look what happened," or "I lost my friend. Look what happened. He betrayed me. Look what happened. It all proves that I'm no good." But Jesus calls us to take our brokenness and put it under the blessing, under the hands of the one who says, "You are my beloved daughter. You are my beloved son. On you, my favor rests. And when you put it under the blessing, you'll be able to say one day the words that Jesus said. And didn't you know that we have to suffer and so enter into our glory? When you put your brokenness under the blessing, then the brokenness can be a pruning in which you're refined and purified, radiant and holy for God. That's not easy, but it is part of the call. Well, finally, friends, you and I are given. You and I are taken, blessed, and broken to be given to the world. You're not there for yourself. I'm not there for myself. I'm there for you, and you're there for me. We're there for each other, and we are there for the generations to come. You know, your life doesn't end on the day you die. Your life is a gift for your family, for your friends, and for beyond that, for people that you will never even see or know about. Jesus doesn't ask us to be successful, but he does ask us to be fruitful. And how can you ever be fruitful without dying? If the grain does not die, it will not bear any fruit. And listen to Jesus. He says, "It is good for you that I go, because when I go, I'll send you my Spirit that will lead you to the full truth, to the full betrothal, to the full espousal," we read in John 16. In Christ's death, we enter into full communion with him. And if you believe that your life is a life in which you are called to give more and more and more of yourself, not just a little bit, but all of you, then you can become food and drink for others when you're willing to pour yourself out for them. You can trust your life will bear immense fruit far beyond your life and beyond your timeline. Oh, and friends, it's so important that we hear that, because we need to know that just as Jesus' death became fruitful for generations and generations to come, anyone who lives like Jesus did, as a beloved son or daughter of God, can be sure that his or her life will bear fruit for ages to come, and that indeed all generations will call you blessed. So be sure to realize that every little bit of giving you do is already part of your becoming fruitful as the beloved. So your life and my life are taken, blessed, broken, and given. And when you go to bed at night, I want you to look over your day and I want you to ask yourself, where was I chosen again? Where was I blessed again? Where was I broken again? Where was I given again? And every time you recognize that, when you recognize the presence of God in your heart, when you recognize the presence of his Spirit in the center of your being, then you will know that you are a beloved daughter and son of God. And you can live a free life, free to love, free to live. God bless you.
Spread.
Friends, thank you for joining us in worship today. Before you go, I just want to share a few announcements with you. The first one, if you haven't joined a small group yet, it is not too late. We've got a number of groups that are meeting virtually at different times each week. Some are every other week. We've also made resources available for those of you who might be interested in starting your own small group with some people that you know and are comfortable with. So head on over to guelphsa.ca/groups and find out how you can get connected in a small group. Well, the days are getting longer. We did spring forward an hour today, and that must mean that spring is in the air. Well, if you like springtime and you like to socialize and you're a lady, well, you're invited to attend a women's ministry virtual spring social next Sunday, March 21st at 3:30 in the afternoon. You're gonna wanna make sure to have a cup of tea or some other favorite spring drink. And because we're looking forward to the lush green of spring, we're asking that you would wear something green. Now, this event is gonna take place over Zoom, and the Zoom link was sent out this past week in the weekly email update. If you didn't get it, don't worry, we'll be sending it out again this week, posting it to our Facebook group, and you can always request the link by emailing the church at office@guelphsa.ca. Now, the last announcement is simply an invitation to you to attend a conversation with our territorial leaders around the new vision for the Canada and Bermuda Territory. Now, this conversation starts on Wednesday, March 24th at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. General Brian Peddle will be joining us from London, England, and a variety of music groups from across the territory will be featured each week. We're confident that God is doing a new thing in Canada and Bermuda, and we're hopeful that you'll join our territorial leaders as we journey together in vision. So please save the date and head over to salvationist.ca/togetherinvision to register for your Zoom link to attend. Well, friends, God's promises endure from generation to generation. So may the God who sent Jesus to redeem us take you, bless you, break you, give you, and make you fruitful. Amen.